With that, I want us to get back to our study in John chapter 14. We're going to complete chapter 14 today, because this is the last little phase of what Jesus closes out his training session that he had with his disciples in the upper room. And the night before he was crucified, you all know the story, Jesus met with his disciples in the upper room, and they observed the Passover meal. And it was there also that he instituted the new memorial meal for the new covenant, the covenant of grace, which is the Lord's Supper, what we call communion. But then he also began to reveal to these men that he was going to leave them. Of course, that gave them all a spiritual heart attack. They were all afraid and freaked out because he said, I'm leaving you, and where I'm going, you can't come. You see, what really bothered these guys was that they believed he was a king, the Messiah. And from their understanding of the scriptures and from the religion of the day, Judaism of the day, they expected the Messiah to set up a kingdom on earth right now and rule the world from Jerusalem. And of course, they've been hanging with the Messiah for the last 3 years. They were close. So they naturally expected that they themselves were going to be rich and famous. They were going to be right there with the king. In fact, they were arguing that very night over which one of them was going to be the greatest. Who was going to be the vice king, so to speak? That was their plan. That was not Jesus' plan. His plan was radically different. Now, I don't know about you all, but I've had a lot of plans that I've told God about. And I've told him exactly what he needs to do and how he needs to get it done. And with whom he needs to do it. I've had my plans over and over again. You can't help it. You've got plans because you're created that way as a spiritual being with the capability of thinking and planning. And you have a self-consciousness, which animals don't have, they just live in the moment, that can project your own awareness of yourself in the future. And so you naturally can make plans. However, those plans that we make are not necessarily what God chooses. Now, I know we try to manipulate him. Naturally, we try to pray, and we pray over and over and over for our plans to be fulfilled, and then they're not, and we too are disappointed, like these disciples. See, God loves us too much to be manipulated by our plans. It's kind of like a small kid, a little child, having the plans of a good afternoon with a book of matches in the backyard with a bunch of dry stuff. He's got plans. He's going to have some fun. But if mama loves that boy, daddy loves that boy, they're going to interrupt his plans. Now, he'll pitch a fit. He'll be irritated with you, swear you don't understand. But that's because he's a child. He's immature. You're actually doing what's best for that child. And see, that's what Jesus' plan was for his disciples. He was going to do not what they wanted, what they thought would make them look and feel good, but what his plan was for them. Even those plans that we set for ourselves, you know, those plans that are a good thing, you know, and we can justify them. In fact, we frequently do by looking at the scriptures and saying, look, God, you said in your word, right? We're justifying our plans by his word. And even those plans, good as they might be and appear to us, are not necessarily the best. And God won't settle for anything less than the best for his children. That's why most of our prayers are not answered. Unanswered prayers are because God knows what's best for us, and he's going to do what's best, not just what's good in our minds, but what is best for us. Now, it's hard for us to accept that. It's hard for us to take that. Because, as you know, all of us have this wonderful knowledge of good and evil, right and wrong, and we already know what's best, right? Unfortunately, that's not the case. God's plan for us is what's best. Now, Jesus had a plan for these men, radically different than their plan. Their plan was to be rich and famous, to rule the world from Jerusalem with the king. That was their plan. Jesus' plan for them was given in that new commandment he gave them. He said, I'm leaving you, and where I'm going, you can't come, and I want you to stay here, and I want you to love other people like I've loved you. Now, the reason that commandment was new is because of the way we are to love people. It's not to love people like you love yourself, which the Old Testament commanded. It's that you are to love people in exactly the same way Jesus does. And that's supernatural. That means you're going to have some supernatural, have to have some supernatural power to do that, to love others like he does. Now, I'm quite sure that they're a lot like us, these disciples. And as soon as he said, I'm leaving you and you can't come with me, they freaked so much they didn't even hear the new commandment. In fact, when Peter asked him a question about it, it wasn't, Lord, where exactly are you going? And why can't we go with you? No, he didn't ask Jesus, how do you want me to love people? How am I going to love people like you? No, he was asking him, where are you going? He had no intention of staying here and loving people. He had no intention of fulfilling Jesus' plan for him. His intention was to be with Jesus wherever he was, wherever he was going, and to be rich and famous. That was not his intention at all, to love people. Of course, Jesus had to rebuke him. And then in chapter 14, as we've been studying all along for the last several weeks, Jesus had to assure these disappointed disciples, confused, freaked out, neurotic. They were all fine. You know what that stands for, right? Freaked out, insecure, neurotic, and emotional. They responded just like we do when God doesn't do what we think he ought to do. He allows stuff we think he should never allow. And he does stuff that we don't think he should ever do. And we freak, just like these disciples did. So Jesus had to assure them, first and foremost, he had to give them that personal assurance that they were going to need to actually fulfill his plan for their lives on this earth after he left. And he gave them seven promises. Seven astounding promises, starting with, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And secondly, if I prepare a place for you, I'm going to come and get you and take you to that place. Then he promised that whoever believed him would do the same works that he was doing, and greater works than these because he was going to the Father. Then he promised that when you're involved in doing his works, you can ask anything in his name, and he would do it, that the Father might be glorified. But he didn't stop there. He went on to say, and on top of that, I promise I'm going to ask the Father, and he's going to give you another of the same kind of comforter I have been to you. He's going to give you a divine, supernatural comforter who will not only be with you, but will be in you, the Spirit of Truth. There's that supernatural source of power. And finally, he promised them that when the Spirit enlightens you and begins to work his work in you, at that day you will know that I am in the Father, and that you are in me, and that I am in you. This last promise is a summary of all other promises. It is because of that union that we have with Christ. Last week we spent quite a bit of time talking about that in terms of other scriptures that Paul revealed more information about. Scriptures like Galatians chapter 2 and his own personal testimony when he said, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in this flesh, in this body, I live by the faith of the Son of God. The same kind of faith Jesus had, who loved me and gave himself for me. What's Paul mean? I'm crucified with Christ. That's the way God joins you together with Christ. The moment you exercise your faith in what Jesus has done for you, the moment you desire to receive his blessings, to do for you what you can't do for yourself, that moment the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, does a radical work in you so that the old person you were born into this world as, that, by the way, is the person you've always thought of yourself as being, that person, that natural identity you had, is crucified with Christ. Buried with him, just like Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, because you're not only crucified and buried, but you're raised up with Christ, created in Christ Jesus as a brand new person. Historically, that happened on the cross over 2,000 years ago. Experientially, that happens when you believe, when you exercise your responsibility to take God at his word. You were crucified with Christ, buried with him, and now you're a brand new person. You're no longer the same person you've always been. Unfortunately, not a lot of Christians today know that. It sounds like we're really far-fetched. What do you mean I'm not the same person I've always been? Of course I'm the same person. What do you mean I've been crucified? I've never been crucified. I never died. Well, we have to make a choice at this point. Are we going to believe our own understanding? Are we going to lean upon our own understanding, believe it, and believe our experience? Or are we going to believe the Word of God? See, it's that faith, that little bitty teeny tiny, less than a grain of mustard seed faith, that pleases God. For without faith, it's impossible to please Him. It's that little bitty faith in what He says is true about you that causes you to live. And whatever is not of faith, whatever we do, however we act, whether it's religious or not, that's not of faith, as far as God is concerned, is sin. So here's the question. Do you believe who God said He made you to be, or are you still believing that you're the same old person you've always been? See, that's the question. If you're still believing you're the same old person you've always been, nothing's happened to you. Even though you may be born of the Spirit, you don't know it. Then your life is going to continue on in a natural downhill slide, fall apart. You're going to be as miserable as everybody else in the world. However, if you choose to believe that you have been crucified with Christ, buried with him, and raised up, that faith is going to allow you to believe that you are a brand new person, capable of living like Christ, loving other people like he does. You see, without that essential faith in your identity, you can't love anybody. If you still think of yourself as the same old person you've always been, you're still wrapped up in selfishness and self-centeredness. You can't love anybody. All you can do is try to manipulate them to make you look or feel good. It's impossible for you to love another person unless you believe that you're a new person. Why? Because you were born selfish. Now, these little kids we had up here, they're cute, man. They're darling little kids. All kids are cute. In fact, all youngsters are cute. Even the young warthog is cute. And God makes them that way because they're also selfish. That little baby, you don't care about his mama. You don't care that she's been up all day and working hard in the middle of night when he wants to get fed, when he's got dirty diapers. He pitches a fit until he gets what he wants when he wants it. You're born that way. Selfish and self-centered. That's the old person we were all once born into this world as. If you continue to identify yourself with that old person in unbelief, then you're going to continue in your selfishness and self-centeredness. And it's going to make you miserable and piss everybody off around you. And you wonder why your relationships fall apart. See, that selfishness, self-centeredness, AA declares, is the root of all our problems. And they're not just talking about addiction to alcohol. All our problems. So what's the answer to that self-centered person we were? God's answer is crucify that sucker. Bury him once and for all. And raise up a new person created in Christ to love other people. That's God's answer to it. And that's what he does upon your faith. You begin to experience the fact that you're a new person. At that day, Jesus said, you'll know that I am in the Father and you are in me. And I'm in you. We're one with Christ. That new person you are is one with Christ so that what's true of him is true of you. That new person you are is one with Christ so that if the Father loves Jesus, he loves you. If the Father thought Jesus was important and had a plan for his life, then you're important, and the Father has a plan for your life. You have the same righteousness as Christ. You have the mind of Christ. You have the Spirit of Christ living inside of you to guide you into all truth, to teach you everything Jesus had to say or will say. You're a member of the body of Christ and are therefore left in this world to be ambassadors for Christ. That's who you are. That's the new person you are. Now, when you believe that, when you exercise faith in that, you have a little hope. That's where hope comes from. Hope comes not from your circumstances, because hope is not happiness. Hope comes from your faith. Hope is generated by your faith in what God says is true. Well, what good is hope? Hope is what keeps you keeping on. Hope is what gives you the endurance that you need to continue on in this world. See, what Jesus was doing was assuring his disciples so they would believe. In fact, he called them over and over again, believe on me, trust me, I know what I'm doing with you, trust me, so they would have hope. A joyful, confident expectation about their future. They would know they're going to be all right. They would know they're not going to lose. And he was constantly assuring them throughout the chapter so that they would have that hope that would free them to actually love other people. So you can't love other people like Christ unless you know you're okay. If you know you're okay, your needs are met, then you can think about others. If you don't, you're going to be too worried about yourself. Now, having assured them, Jesus closes his initial training in the upper room with one final promise. I want us to look at this promise. Beginning in chapter 14, verse 27, Jesus says these words, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If you loved me, you would rejoice, because I said, I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I've told you these, I told you before it come to pass, that when it has come to pass, you might believe. Now here's the promise. The promise is peace. No matter what's happening in our world, no matter what's going on around us, either on the personal level, or in the local societal level, national level, world level, no matter what's going on around us, Jesus said, I'm going to give you peace. My peace. Now, he's not talking, he contrasts it right here. He says, it's not the kind of peace you would naturally get from the world. What kind of peace is that? Well, it's the kind of peace that you feel when things are going your way. When nobody's criticizing you. Nobody's giving you problems or grief. When everything's working out for your good. When you experience things going your way, you have peace from the world. But as soon as somebody disrupts that, by criticizing you or opposing you or in some way offending you, suddenly your peace is gone. And you're threatened on a personal level. Same thing happens to you every day. Every time you turn on the TV and look at the news, your peace is gone. Every time. You don't have peace. Their job is to worry you. The world doesn't give you peace. Causes you to worry in hopes that they can manipulate you to do something they think you ought to do. You ain't got peace. You're worried. Well, what about this? What about that? Well, who's going to be the president? What's he going to do? You know, peace. You're worried. See, the world can only offer you a counterfeit, quote, peace. Jesus is not talking about that peace. He's talking about his peace. Now check this out. He's talking about the peace he himself had personally in the middle of the storm on the sea that allowed him to take a nap when everybody else was freaking thinking we'll all be killed. Jesus went to sleep, took a nap. That's the kind of peace he's leaving with us. It's the kind of peace that comes, that inward contentment and satisfaction that comes from knowing that you are secure in Him. That in order for anything to come into your life, good, bad, or ugly, it's got to have permission from the Father and then from Jesus Himself. And then when it gets to you, it's got to deal with Jesus in you through His Spirit. The peace of knowing that you are absolutely able to face any situation in the power of God. The peace of knowing that you can never be forsaken, that you can never lose, no matter what it looks like or feels like. That's the peace Jesus promised his disciples. Radically different than the peace the world offers, I understand. So he's not talking about the kind of peace the world will give you or promise you, more likely, hardly ever follow through, but promise you, according to your circumstances, according to your behavior, is the peace that Jesus said, I'm going to give you. It's my peace. It's the same kind of peace he had when he faced the opposition of the religious folks of his day. It's the same kind of peace he had when people tried to kill him and were plotting his death. And he knew his hour has not yet come. It's the kind of peace he had when he reached out to a leper and touched a man who was clean. You see, it's the kind of peace that Jesus had. Not ruffled, not worried, not threatened, not anxious. He wasn't worried about how much money he had or didn't have. He wasn't worried about what kind of house he lived in. He wasn't worried about any of that stuff. The world says you have to have peace. He had peace. He had that same peace that Paul was talking to the Philippians about in Philippians 4, that peace that belongs to God, the peace that passes our understanding. Doesn't make sense to us. Doesn't make sense because our circumstances are so threatening, we ought to freak. But instead, we have peace. Peace that passes all understanding. Jesus promised his disciples peace. Now, he gives them the way of peace here. When he said, I've told you these things before they happen, so that when they happen, you can believe. You see, this is where peace comes from. It comes from your faith. That little bitty tiny, less than a grain of mustard seed faith that you have in what God says is true about you. That faith is what Jesus is after. Because from that faith, when you believe that you're okay, you believe that you can't lose, you believe who you are, you have identified yourself so closely with Jesus, and you realize that you and he are one, you realize that the only way you can lose is if Jesus loses. The only way you can fail is if Jesus fails. When you realize that, and that hope springs up, that joyful, confident expectation about your future, no matter what happens, you have that hope that allows you to endure the sufferings that were coming or the threatenings of this world. You're able to turn the corner and actually begin to care about somebody besides yourself. And that's a miracle. To actually care about somebody else, to actually love another person like Christ. Where does that come from? It comes from the hope you have. Where does that come from? It comes from the faith. That's why Paul said, now abides these three, faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love, but the first of these is faith. It produces that hope that allows us to love. Now, earlier Jesus said, whoever loves me, whoever really loves me, will do what I tell them to do. Will obey my commandments. And I know religious folks take this all out of context and they say, if you really love Jesus, you'll obey his commandments, and then they tell you what his commandments are to make them look good. Now, keep it in the context. His commandment concerns your purpose, your ultimate purpose for being here. It's that new commandment he gave back in chapter 13 at the beginning of his upper room discourse. It is that new commandment to love others like he does. You see, when you're so identified with Christ that you become one with him and you believe what's true of him is true of you, you're able to have that hope that allows you to turn the corner and quit being so selfish and self-centered, the only person you can think about is yourself, and start caring about other people just like Jesus did. And when that happens, you keep his commandments. You see, he's going to tell you how to love. It's not up to you. You don't know how to love. All you know how to do is leech. You don't know how to love. It's up to him. He's got to direct you. He's got to tell you what to speak, what to say. He's got to tell you what to do, where to go. Those are his commands, as he commands you to love one another. Jesus said, whoever loves me is going to keep my commands. And now he's saying, in connection with the peace that he promises here, that when you do keep his commands, when you love him and are identified with him enough to actually love other people like he does, you're going to have a satisfaction you've never experienced before. You're going to have his peace. You see, his peace doesn't come by changing your circumstances. His peace comes by you loving other people like he does. That's where it comes from. His peace. The same kind of peace he had. The same kind of peace he was exhibiting right then and there to his disciples, knowing that he was going to be arrested within several hours, beaten, falsely accused, and finally crucified. He had peace. Why? Because he was following the commands of the Father. I want you to see just real quickly how it's demonstrated as we close. How is this peace demonstrated? He said in verse 30, "Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me, but that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father has given me commandment, even so I do." What's he talking about here? Number one, he tells his disciples, from now on, I'm not going to talk a lot with you. Most of his training, at least the verbal training, was over in the upper room. He was closing that part of his training. And now he is going to train them by example. See, there's two ways we train people. We train them in a classroom, and we train them by example. In other words, we train them by what we say, and we train them by what we do. And what we say and what we do need to match each other. Otherwise, they're confused. So Jesus said, I'm not going to use a lot of words on you now. I'm going to show you what it means to love. I'm not going to command you to love and give you an academic understanding of what God's love is and how you receive it, etc. I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you what love looks like. And in the hours ahead, he would display the greatest manifestation of the love of God the world has ever seen. How is he going to do that? He is going to know that the Father loves him. Faith. He is going to know what the Father commanded him to do. And he is determined to do it. Not just think about it, not just contemplate it, but get on with it and do it. Now, that is the ultimate expression of faith, by the way. Like James says, faith without works is dead, being alone. If you believe, you truly believe who you are in Christ, you're going to act like it by loving other people. If you truly believe that you're one with Christ, you're going to live it out by loving other people like Christ. You, in essence, are going to be Christ to others. What Jesus is saying is, I'm not just going to talk the talk anymore. I'm going to walk the walk. I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you what love looks like. A few hours later, when he got into the garden, he fulfilled the prophecy. When he submitted himself, brought it on himself, submitted himself to a literal shockwave, a tsunami of grief and astonishment, emotional stress like you can't begin to fathom. Why? He worried about dying on the cross? No. It was at that moment that he fulfilled Isaiah's prophecy, as he bore our griefs and carried our sorrows. He felt the pain, the suffering, the emotional upheaval of every human being, from Adam to the last man. He felt it all himself, took it upon himself to bear our griefs and carry our sorrows. So heavy was that emotional tsunami that overtook him, he dropped to his knees, fell on his face, and began to sweat blood. It would have killed him had he not prayed. You all know the famous prayer. Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. He was honest with God. It didn't feel good. Loving people like Christ doesn't feel good all the time. In fact, sometimes it'll cause you to sweat drops of blood with emotional upheaval in your life. If it possible, Father, let this cup pass from me. I don't want to have to go through this. I don't want to have to do this. Nevertheless, not my will, not my plan, but yours be done. You see that faith? He believed that God loved him enough to do what was best for him. Not just what would make him feel good, but what was best for him. How do we love people like Christ? We follow his commandments by submitting our plan to him. I learned this early on in my ministry when I was trying to study the Bible, because I thought in order to be a good preacher, you got to study the Bible, you know. You got to at least know what the Bible says. And so I got into studying about 8 hours a day for a while. And it used to really piss me off when somebody would interrupt me. I'm doing important stuff here now. I'm studying the Bible. I got 7 different classes I got to teach every week, and I'm studying the Bible, and I'm preparing all that. What are you doing interrupting me? And it dawned on me. Those interruptions were people who needed something. People who needed love. People who needed somebody to care about them. Somebody to listen to them. Somebody to bear their sorrows and their griefs. But I was too busy studying. And it dawned on me. Those interruptions, that is your opportunity to love people. Now you can look at them as an interruption of your plan if you want to. And you can be all mad at them and get angry and wind up hating them. Or you can look at it as the leadership of God in your life, telling you who to love. See, Jesus was, by example, going to show these guys what the new commandment was all about. He did so, first of all, in the garden. Now, you know the story, how he asked them to pray. I want you guys to stay here and pray. And then he took Peter, James, and John, the troublemakers, with him. Because he couldn't let them out of his sight. They'd be out doing something crazy. So he took them with him and said, now you stay here and pray, and I'm going to go right here and pray. I'll be back. And he prayed that prayer. He came back, and the boys were sound asleep. And it fell out. So he woke them up, and he said, now I want you to pray. Went back, and he prayed the same prayer. If it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, thy will be done. Came back. They were asleep again. Woke him up, said, I know, the spirit's willing, the flesh is weak. And he went back and he prayed a third time. This time it wasn't, if it be possible for this cup to pass from me. It was, since it's not possible for me to get out of this, your will be done. What do you suppose Jesus was feeling from that time till the time Judas showed up at his arrest with the band of soldiers from the temple guard? What do you suppose Jesus was feeling at that time? The writer of Hebrews gives us a little insight into that. Because he had given his will to the Father, believed the Father loved him and was going to do what was best for him. He himself experienced that joy of hope. He experienced his peace, the peace he's going to leave with you. He wasn't worried. In fact, when he came back and saw him sleeping this time, he said, go ahead, sleep. Rest up. You're going to need it. He loved him because he had hope. He had peace. Like the writer of Hebrews says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the Father. Even under the worst of circumstances, Jesus loved his disciples. It didn't stop there. It went on all the way through as he dealt with Peter at his trial. And even as he hung on the cross and he provided for his mother. You see, Jesus wasn't thinking of himself. He was thinking of his job that the Father had sent him to do, to show the world his love. That was his mission. That's why he came. He didn't come to judge the world. The world was condemned already. He came to show the world of his love for them. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes on him should not perish but have everlasting life. See, that was God's heart, to love the world. Now, what he wants us to do, having received that love, we can love him by loving others, just like he did. Is it going to be a bowl of cherries? Of course not. Does that mean you're not going to have any more suffering in your life? Of course not. You live in a sin-cursed world that's falling apart, and sin-cursed bodies that are falling apart. You're going to suffer. Jesus will talk about that later. What does it mean? It means you can have his peace. You see, when you trust God concerning your new nature, your new identity, you have that hope, that joy that he had, that allows you to start caring about other people, that breaks your own selfishness and self-centeredness long enough for you to actually love someone else like Christ. And when you do, you have that peace that passes all understanding. You realize that you're not here to be fat, dumb, and happy and feel good and go on vacation. You realize that you're here to love other people, and that's where your peace comes from. See, that's what God created you to do. That's who he created you to be. He didn't create you to be selfish. He created you to be Christ. And Jesus, telling his disciples, look, from now on, I'm not going to talk much about this. I'm just going to show you. From that point on, displayed in his life, in his sacrifice on the cross, the greatest love the world has ever seen. The greatest display of God was in that cross, whereby he transformed a selfish and self-centered human race into a glorious race, a new creation, a glorious gathering of kings and priests, a royal generation, a holy nation. On that cross, he was able to defeat the enemy that had nothing in him, had no power or authority over him. Now, he's done with the upper room academics. Okay, he's done with that. And so he says, let's go on. Arise, get up, let's go. And he finishes the chapter with, it's time to move. I think it's a call to faith. If we believe what he said to assure us of who we are and why we're here and what he has given us and all of those promises, it's time for us to move. It's time for us to get on. It's time for us to walk the walk. It's all going to be conditioned upon your faith, whether you believe in who you are and why you're here or not. But those who do will do the works of Christ. Those who do will be empowered by his Spirit, led by his mind, to love other people, to actually be Christ to others. Right there in your home, the people you're living with, on your job, in school, in the community. You see, that's your high calling of God in Christ Jesus that he's prepared us for. Next week, Lord willing, we're going to go on into chapter 15, because he didn't stop talking there. They got up and left, walked out of the upper room, walked down the steps, walked through the streets of Jerusalem and out the eastern gate on their way to the Garden of Gethsemane. And Jesus continued to instruct them with some object lessons, like he did normally when they followed him, and therefore has a lot of good instruction for us as well. So we're going to continue on next week. But here's an important turning point. The important turning point is whether or not you believe that that's why you're here. Whether or not you believe that that's why you're still breathing, why you're still alive. And God's got a job for you to do to love other people like Christ. Whether or not you believe that is going to determine the quality of your life. Whether or not you accept that high calling of God in Christ Jesus by faith is going to determine your choices, your decisions. It's going to determine your lifestyle. It's going to determine whether you love Jesus or not. You see, those who love Jesus love other people. Now, every one of us has the capacity. It's already given. It's already done. On that cross, Jesus did everything necessary to make you a brand new person. Everything. That's why he said, "It is finished. It's a done deal. It's over. I've completed it." Question is whether we'll believe it or not. Let's pray. Father God, as we come into your presence, I thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the message you've given us, the assurances that you've given us concerning who you've made us to be and why we're here and what our lives are about. I thank you for the peace that you promised, Lord Jesus. The peace of knowing who we are and why we're here and where we're going. That peace that passes all understanding. I thank you for the precious promises you've revealed to us so far. And I ask you to help us take it to heart. Help us in our unbelief to accept the reality of who you've made us to be. Lord, it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Appreciate you all being here. Go in peace.